conference or the coalition will be doing, but certainly we would want the issue of Haiti and the occupation of Haiti and the withdrawal of Latin American troops from Haiti some way, somehow, added on to one of the focus areas of the Latin America coalition that has put together this event. So I just wanted to mention that quickly as a way of us moving forward together. Thank you.
If there, if I'd like to open the floor, especially to questions at this point, to for any of the panelists, we can take a few more. I think. Are there any questions?
For the compañera from Ciudad Juárez, I was wondering about the femicides that were before the federal army was sent in to fight the drug war under the current president. There were the hundreds of women have been killed in Ciudad Juárez. Has that continued at the same level, and then now there are more killings on top? Or has there been any progress in finding any of the guilty of those murders?
Are there others before we begin? Other questions for any of the panelists? There, back there.
Yeah, my question is, as far as the issue of Haiti or other, Central American countries that being seen as South or Central America, what's the, what would you suggest to solve that issue? Is that something that can be solved through government, or is it just something that the people, South Americans in particular, has to kind of raise up and, you know, help with?
Thank you. Other questions?
Okay. I already had a mic. I was wondering, so between everyone that's here and then those today que están acá, do you see like a possibility, like an intra-regional coalition building, you know, within Latin America, and how we can move that forward as far as the film solidarity here as well?
I think we can have a round of answers for answers, and then
bueno, pues en principio respecto a lo del feminicidio, esto no solamente ha continuado, está peor. Ahorita tenemos del perfil de la mujer pobre, que es de las maquiladoras, se ha pasado a jóvenes estudiantes, o sea, el perfil se ha abierto. Y lo que pasa, ahorita tenemos 174 asesinatos el año pasado de mujeres. En lo que va de este año fueron 19 en enero, 10 en febrero, 13 en marzo y había 2 en el mes de abril. Esto, y no se habla de infancia, tendríamos que hablar de infancia también, que las cifras son escalofriantes. Lo que pasa es que queda oculto con la magnitud de todos los crímenes y ante todo este caos, ¿no? Pero el feminicidio sigue, las violaciones y la desaparición de mujeres, mucho por ello a través del negocio de la trata de personas.
Gracias. Yo solo quisiera agregar sobre el tema de los feminicidios, que es un tema que ha agarrado una importancia muy fuerte en la agenda de Honduras, que hoy las compañeras de Just Associates hicieron una actividad en las diferentes embajadas de Honduras en todo el mundo, exigiendo el cese a la violencia contra las mujeres en el país. Hubieron acciones en embajadas en México, en Guatemala, en Centroamérica y en Sudamérica, y que las compañeras de, incluso también de Juárez, creo, de coordinación de Just Associates, en este sentido, porque es un patrón muy parecido que se empezó a aplicar en Juárez y se ha convertido también en una manera de crear miedo, de atacar militancia, de atacar a compañeras con actividad política o no, y en definitiva de generar un nivel de violencia que justifica muchas cosas. Sabemos que las mujeres asesinadas en Honduras no todas tenían participación política, pero todas fueron asesinadas por ser mujeres. Entonces esa es la bandera que hay que levantar en esta lucha, y eso sí podríamos hacer de manera coordinada ya, que es unirse las organizaciones que sean feministas o de mujeres a darse cuenta de que en América Latina están matando a mujeres por decenas, estamos hablando por cientos en todo el continente de manera mensual. Eso es un exterminio y es necesario tomar acciones al respecto.
Bolivar's dream of Latin American integration is probably closer today than it ever has been since he dreamed it. And for me, that's one of the really exciting things about what's happening in Latin America and why it's an example for us in the world. Latin America is charting its own path without the United States doing the driving. And that is something that I think our solidarity movement needs to be very aware of and be extremely supportive of, because that, I think, is the hope of the world.
The question about violence against women is something that Haiti has experienced a great deal of. We experience it's a direct result of militarism, where rape, mass rape, and mutilation of women is a weapon of war. Basically, it's to terrorize, as the brother said, as everyone has said, the women, but also to terrorize the entire population. And so we experienced that massively during the coup d'etat, the first coup d'etat against President Aristide, where the FRAP death squad was doing mass gang rapes even against children. We are talking 7-year-olds. They were forcing family members to rape or to have intercourse with their parents in full view of the, and this is a matter of record. So when I hear about these incidents, and as we see now, the UN troops have been stand accused. There have been many accusations against them for raping and violence against women and forcing child prostitution and all those vices, all that violence against people. So that's something that's a direct result of militarization and the intimidation, which is part of that. On the issue of that the brother raised earlier about Haiti and what name the struggle. You know, going back to Brother Malcolm X, the great Malcolm X, he said he was appealing to African Americans, people of African descent in the US. And he said, we must broaden our scope to see African Americans not confined within the borders of the United States, but it should be from Greenland south to Tierra del Fuego. And this is something I think holds true, not just for people of African descent, but for all of us who are engaged in this struggle. Because mind you, the School of the Americas, they have different campuses. They divide it about language, but in Haiti, up to 1963 or 64, Haiti used to send troops regularly to the SOA. And Adrian Aaron has a fantastic article called Haiti, the case, SOA, the case of Haiti. And it details and it gives some of the people who are graduates of the SOA in the Haitian military. And they have other campuses where they deal, where they send people who speak English and people who speak French and Creole. That's what they send them. So basically the training they get is very integrated. To close on that, the bosses, the imperialists, those people who are fostering this kind of militarized violence against people, they think globally. They have formed themselves in regions. See, they don't discriminate. They come together to better oppressors. But we, unfortunately, the solidarity movement, are the ones who I'm not saying that you do, but generally people are compartmentalizing it and not uniting the struggle where we could pool our resources and be more effective in our response.
Bueno, quisiera también aprovechar para dar nuestros puntos de vista sobre una coalición latinoamericana y el aporte del pueblo estadounidense para ayudar a solucionar este problema. Pues el pueblo latinoamericano estamos luchando muy duro para bregar a cambiar todo este sistema de muerte que han venido creando los gobiernos, todos los gobiernos de turno, han ido creando un problema social de fondo que es el verdadero problema de la guerra. Las armas vienen posterior al verdadero problema de la guerra, que es un problema social que los gobiernos no han querido solucionar. Entonces, yo creo que el pueblo latinoamericano estamos trabajando para buscar esa unidad de lucha. Diferentes organizaciones indígenas, campesinos y afrodescendientes. Eso todavía falta porque toda la política de los Estados Unidos es muerte y que los gobiernos han cogido con mucha fuerza. Pero esperamos que un día podamos cambiar esto. En cuanto al aporte del pueblo estadounidense, yo creo que el pueblo estadounidense tiene que pronunciarse contra el gobierno de los Estados Unidos, contra el Congreso, que los pueblos latinoamericanos no necesitamos armas. Las armas están hechas para matar y nosotros, el pueblo latinoamericano, queremos vivir en dignidad. Necesitamos resolver ese problema social que tenemos. Entonces, interceder ante el Congreso y ante el gobierno de los Estados Unidos, que ya es justo toda la sangre que han derramado. Pareciera que el alimento de los gobiernos de los Estados Unidos fuera sangre. Ya estamos hastiados de ello. Que por favor no más armas, no más logística militar, no más dólares para pagar a estos criminales que nos están asesinando. Y lo último, que el pueblo estadounidense pueda interceder ante el gobierno para que no pase lo del Tratado de Libre Comercio en Colombia y en Latinoamérica. Esta es la raíz de los verdaderos problemas para nosotros. Muchas gracias.
Sí, en relación a las sugerencias que podemos hacer, creo que podrá, en mi país, salir el último mexicano, todos los mexicanos, a decir no más sangre, no queremos esta guerra, no la decidimos, no queremos seguir muriendo y no seremos escuchados. Lo único que nuestros gobiernos escuchan es el mandato de Washington. De ahí que el detonante del cambio sean ustedes, sean las campañas efectivas, como lo apuntaba desde el principio, que esta palabra se convierte en acción, y una acción que a través del ciberespacio puede tocar conciencias. Hagamos de todos la consigna no más sangre en cada uno de nuestros países, no más sangre a cambio de dólares o a cambio de dinero, no más sangre en esta rueda absurda, esta lógica absurda. Y en cuanto a la coalición, yo creo que la voz de los deudos es muy importante, que visibilicemos a quienes han sido tocados por esta tragedia, lamentablemente, y que logremos que se abran espacios para que su voz sea escuchada, para que se intercambien y hacer una red de deudos porque creo que es la voz que más confianza tiene para que este, tengan una visibilidad. Y lo que nosotros hemos dicho, tanto miedo le tiene Estados Unidos a los migrantes, pero están generando tal imposibilidad para que vivamos en nuestros países que les vamos a hacer una petición masiva de asilo, a ver qué hace con 10,000 mexicanos pidiendo asilo en los puentes internacionales.
We're out of time for more questions. I want to ask, are you, you're gonna close it? What? Oh, all right. Okay, well, I'm on behalf of AU's anthropology department, on behalf of AU, I wanna thank you all so much for coming to tonight's plenary. We're very excited about the next 2 days. And again, to thank all the wonderful speakers tonight for their really important contributions. So thank you. Okay, and so Alexis has a couple announcements.
Yeah, thanks everybody. Oh, got a lot of announcements, hold on. So I just want to reiterate what Adrian said, to thank all of our panelists so very much, not only for bringing forth the voices and the struggles of the communities that they come from and the organizations and movements that they represent, but also for giving us incredibly clear analysis of the roots of the problem and of the challenges that we face, and very much looking forward to workshops and conversations and discussions happening over the next couple of days to talk about building the kind of movements we need to meet those challenges. I also want to say a very, very special thank you to the people who are filming tonight's plenary, and also thank you to both of our interpreters, Sylvia Brandon Perez from the Vice Presidency, thank you so much, and Marta Duncan as well. Thank you both so much for the wonderful, wonderful presentation. Another round of thank you for our musicians, Vientos del Sur and Cosita Seria, for sharing this off tonight. Announcements about, well, another very important reminder that everyone who has equipment for interpretation needs to return it outside to the table and check yourself off that you don't, that you gave it back, so we don't call you and harass you about it. Another announcement from the registrars, for Kathleen Kalau and Frank Benjamin, please see the registrar, either Helen or Gail, outside. Great, and then also there's something that's missing from tomorrow's program announcement, which is that registration is gonna be from 8:30 to 10. Many of you hopefully have already registered. And then there's a very wonderful and exciting welcoming plenary starting at 10, from 10 to 11. And it's gonna be led by Hector Aristizabal, who is a Colombian artist, former political prisoner. Many of you have heard him maybe this week reading from his new book, but he has done a lot of work with the Theater of the Oppressed, and he's gonna lead us in a participatory workshop to bring people together, to get people to know each other, and to, you know, start to build the kind of community that movements need to survive. So it's gonna be a really wonderful way to start out the morning. I really encourage you all to get a big cup of coffee and be here by 10, and beforehand, if you haven't registered. Also, there's going to be a workshop change for people who have their programs with them, and we'll also make this clear on the signs that will be outside.